Good morning and welcome to Travis Baptist this morning. If we'd stand, we'll get started with singing, "This is the Day."
This is a day, this is a day that the Lord hath made, that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is a day that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is a day, this is a day that the Lord hath made. This is a day, this is a day that the Lord hath made, that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is a day that the Lord hath made, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord hath made.
Today's scripture reading is from 1 John 4, 9 through 11. In this, the love of God was manifested toward us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him.
In this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us.
And sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins.
Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another.
All right, let's pray together. Father and our God, it is so good to know you and to know that before we ever knew you, even knew you existed, you loved us. You formed us in the womb of our mothers. You lovingly formed us and fit us, and now here we are, Lord, in your family. And we are so grateful to you for loving us like this. And we pray, God, you can forgive us and cleanse us and make us right with you. We pray for all those who are struggling this morning, wondering if you could actually love them. Let them know today, Lord, yes, your love knows no bounds. Nothing can stop it. There's no obstacle your love can't overcome. There's no past, there's no sin, there's no shame that you cannot wash away. Lord, we are so grateful that you love us like this, and so we pray that we will discover all that we are in Christ and all that you have done and made us to be. Help us to see, Lord, as we face the struggles of life, help us to see that you are there and you have given us everything we need to overcome. We pray these things in the name of your Son, Christ. Amen. Thank you, and you can be seated. We are glad you're with us here today, and got a few announcements coming up. Let me see. This evening, 6:30 p.m., we're continuing our study on the book of Revelation at 6:30 over in the Fellowship Hall. Monday and Tuesday, as you hopefully have heard, our brother Ralph Carriaga passed away this last week. We are going to have visitation for him at Memory Gardens. We'll be from 5 to 7 p.m. on Monday, and then there'll be a service at 7 p.m. And then on Tuesday morning, we're going to have another kind of prayer service for Ralph, and then at 11 a.m. out at Memory, this is all out at Memory Gardens, there will be the burial at 11, and so please be in prayer for that. The family will be having a lunch, that'll be here at the church at about 11:45, 12 o'clock, that time. So those of you that are bringing food, that gives you an idea of what's happening, okay? But there's his schedule. It's on the back of your bulletin. And so please keep Hazel and her family in prayer. Then on Wednesday, we will be back with our regular Wednesday service. It is Grand Prix night for Awana. And then we'll be having the prayer meeting Bible study going on at 6:30. Next Sunday will be a busy day. We've got our Vacation Bible School meeting at 4:30 p.m. We'll have a deacons meeting at 5, and then we've got business meeting at 6:30 next Sunday. So keeping all that in mind, all right? And we are glad you're here today. Good to see you. If you're here for the first time or the first time in a long time, we've got a little flap here on our bulletin cover. And if you wouldn't mind sharing some of your information about us, we'll follow up with you and get you more information about our church. You can also upgrade your phone numbers and addresses and emails and a prayer request or anything like that on this. And it tears right off, and you can drop it in the offering plate when it comes by later. Thank you for doing that. And let's take some time now. And let's go around and welcome one another into the Lord's house.
As we make it back to our places, we will continue to stand as we make it back to our places. And join me in singing, "You Are My All in All." You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all. Seeking you as a precious jewel, Lord, to give up I'd be a fool. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Taking my sin, my cross, my shame, rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all.
fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name.
Amen. At this time, the children may be excused to head up to children's church. As they head out, the rest of us will sing, "He Keeps Me Singing."
There's within my heart a melody, Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee, peace be still, in all of life's ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Feasting on the riches of his grace, resting neath his sheltering wing, always looking on his smiling face, that is why I shout and sing. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Soon he's coming back to welcome me, far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown, I shall reign with him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go.
And please be seated.
All right, it is time to pray. And as mentioned, we want to be in prayer for the Carriaga family as they are grieving and as they are all the things that have to be done when you've lost a loved one. And so do remember, we've got Monday evening and Tuesday morning, whichever one you can make, would love to have you there. But be praying for them. Also, we've got Patty Estes, and be praying for her. They are working on a plan for giving treatment to the liver. It is a stage 4, and they believe it is metastasized from her previous breast cancer. So keep her in your prayers, especially at all that she and her husband are going through. And we've got so many other things. We've got Vacation Bible School coming up. We've got a big night with Awana's Grand Prix. We usually get the parents to come and stick around for a while. So we want to be in prayer for God to work through us this week and continue to work in every week. Want to thank everybody who helped out yesterday cleaning up in here and the fellowship. And we fixed a couple of potholes out in the parking lot. And just thank all of y'all who showed up and worked. And we are grateful for that. But let's be in prayer. Let's be in prayer for one another, for God to change us into what he wants us to be, that he might build this church, use this church as he sees fit, and that he might continue blessing this neighborhood through us. So let's bow before him. The altar is open. Come and pray for someone you know that needs Christ. Come and pray for this neighborhood, for our school system. Come and pray for the many needs that we have all around us, the main needs in your life, the people you know that need Christ. Come to the altar and pray. Let's bow our heads. Come and pray. Father in heaven, how good it is to know that you're listening to our hearts right now. You see into us. You not only know what we're asking, you also know what we really need. And you don't hesitate to bring that about. We lift up so many before you, Lord. The Cariagas, the Estes families. We lift up the person next to us in the pew. We lift up these in the altar. We lift up, Lord, those out in the foyer and those that are upstairs. We lift them up to you, Lord. These are your children. God, would you wrap them up in your arms and bless them? Would you pour the Holy Spirit out upon them in a way that their lives are unmistakably changed? Would you fill our hearts with yourself and with your word and with your spirit that we might have the power to overcome all the things that are dragging us down? Would you work a miracle in our life to let us see you doing great and mighty things that we can only stand up and shout your praises for? God, would you work in us? Would you work on us and make us like your Son? We pray, God, for Awana, for Sunday school, for the Bible study ministries we have going on. We pray for those of our members that are trying to meet new people. Lord, that you would create opportunities for us, open doors for us, create situations that we never saw coming. And there we are, ready to serve you, ready to speak for you, because you've given us the words we need to say. We have no fear, we have no hesitation, because our God is with us and in us. And so, God, we pray. We pray for all those that are here, that you would grant the desires of their hearts, that you would grant them the grace and the healing that they need, that you would bless them with the strength that will overcome their obstacles, that you would move in them, that they might follow you more closely and hang on to you every moment of the day and of their lives. God, would you bless this church, these people. Do a great thing for them. Let this city see you in us. We pray these things in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Join with me in singing Heaven Came Down.
wonderful, wonderful day, day I will never forget. After I'd wandered in darkness away, Jesus, my Savior, I met. Oh, what a tender, compassionate friend, he met the need of my heart. Shouted dispelling with joy, I'm telling, he met all the darkness depart. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole, my sins were washed away, and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Born of the Spirit with life from above, into God's family divine, justified fully through Calvary's love, oh, what a standing is mine. And the transaction so quickly was made, when as a sinner I came. Took of the offer of grace he did proffer, he saved me, oh, praises to name. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole, my sins were washed away, and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. Now I've a hope that will surely endure after the passing of time. I have a future in heaven for sure, there in those mansions sublime. And it's because of that wonderful day, when at the cross I believed. Riches eternal and blessings supernal, for his precious hand I received. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole, my sins were washed away, and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul.
At this time, if we stand for the offering, we'll sing For the Beauty of the Earth.
Pray with me. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the time granted to be in your house, to worship you, to honor you, to glorify your name, to pray for forgiveness for our sins. Bless this offering. that it will bring new souls to your work, Lord God, all over the world, in our city, in our state, in our nation, overseas. We pray for our congregation, everyone in attendance. We pray for those that are ill. Lord God, be with them. We pray for those that have lost a loved one. Lord God, comfort them in the coming days. Hazel and the family, be with them, Lord God. We ask these things in your holy name. Amen.
Good morning again. We're glad you're here. We're going to be in Romans, the book of Romans, chapter 5. And we'll be reading today from verses 1 through 11. Romans chapter 5, continue our little series on being more than conquerors. And today, talking about the idea that we are equipped to overcome. In other words, no excuses. We've got what we need to be what God is calling us to be. To deal with the challenges we have in life, to face whatever comes our way. Sometimes it seems unfair that so much gets thrown at us. Sometimes it feels like we're just bombarded. But in the end, really, God has us. And God has given us what we need to make our way through it all. So, we're going to be in Romans, the book of Romans. Matthew in your New Testament starts out Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, the book of Acts, and then Romans. Romans chapter 5, and we'll read verses 1 through 11. Would you stand, please, for the reading of God's Word? Romans chapter 5, and we'll read verses 1 through 11. Romans chapter 5, verse 1. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom also we have access by faith into the grace in which we stand, and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And not only that, but we also glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance, and perseverance, character, and character, hope. Now hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. For when we were still without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet perhaps for a good man someone would dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love towards us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more then, having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. For if, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, much more, having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. And not only that, but we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received the reconciliation. Let's pray. You are good, God. Even though bad things happen in life, you are good. Even though some things hit us the wrong way, you are good. And you are going to help us through this. So we pray, Lord, for every soul that's struggling right now, to let them know that there is a way through this. We pray these things in the name of your Son. Amen. Thank you, and you can be seated. We get promised, and we think in the back of our minds, now that we're with Jesus and he promised us abundant life, I won't have any more problems. We tell you when we're trying to lead you to Christ, we tell you he'll give you peace, he'll give you joy, he'll give you a lot of stuff, and yes, he will. And then Monday hits, and Mondays hit hard, don't they? And sometimes it may be the rest of the week too, and you got to go to the doctor and it's not good news. And you look at the bank account and it's worse news. And you look on the TV and there's nothing happy there. And you're looking around and saying, where is that abundant life? When we suddenly think, maybe Jesus bailed on us. Maybe none of it was true. But what if we took a look into his word and see what he's really doing in us and with us and through us to see why these things are coming our way? Why these struggles are like this for us? Is it because I've done things wrong? Is he unhappy with me? Am I too much of a lost cause? Or could it really be that God has a bigger plan in this? So we come to chapter 5. And we've been going through the book of Romans the last few weeks. If you want to get caught up, it's on you can get the links through our Facebook page to the previous messages. But let's remember, in Romans, we were talking about the great power of the gospel, because the gospel of Jesus Christ is the power of God to salvation. That Jesus Christ died according to the scriptures, was buried, and rose the third day according to the scriptures. That is God's power to whoever believes. The power to change you. And then he told us in chapter 2, you know, really, it's God's kindness that leads us to Jesus. It's not God threatening us with hell. It's the fact that we need to be overwhelmed by how much he loves us and what all he's done for us. And we come to chapter 3, and there, boy, in chapter 3, it's telling us, you are sinners. We've all sinned. There is none righteous. No, not one. See, Pastor, he's just telling us we're sinners. He's coming down hard. Yes, he is. And then in the middle of chapter 3, he turns around and says, but God has done all this for us. He has redeemed us. He has justified us. He has given us a sacrifice. He's done it all, literally crossing heaven and earth to bring us into his family. And in chapter 4, as we saw last week, and we talked about how strong that faith is that justifies us. And now we come to chapter 5, and if you're still wondering, is God on my side or not? Is God angry with me? Is God, would he take someone like me? We start out in chapter 5, verse 1, and we see we have been justified faith. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. What he wants you to know right now is that when you come to Christ, we've got something. That though we feel like we've been strangers with God, though we feel we've been alienated, now because of Jesus, those who believe in him, whether you're feeling that or not, the fact is, yes, you can come close. Because we believe in Jesus Christ, we are equipped with three things. First off, we get peace. being justified by faith. What does that mean? Because we believe God declared us innocent. We are now righteous. Even, dare I say, perfect in His eyes. Oh, I'm not perfect. No, you're not. But when He looks like you, you know, when we look down at our babies and we look at them and we think they're perfect, you never focus on how they spit up, how they cry, how you got to change them, how you got to wash them, all that stuff. In those moments, they're not so perfect. But boy, when they're being sweet and they're asleep, aren't they perfect? And God looks at us as His children, and every parent looks at their children as if they are the most wonderful in the world. And God has justified us and made us perfect, made us righteous, made us innocent in His sight. And because of that, we are no longer enemies with Him. The boundary of sin has been removed from us. And we have peace with God. There is no more enmity. There is no more reason to feel like you're rejected. There is no more reason to feel like He wouldn't want you. No, there's peace now. The second thing we've got with Him is grace. We move on to verse 2. Through whom this same Jesus, through whom also we have access by faith into this grace in which we stand. Because of faith, we've got access to God's grace. Now, what is God's grace? We like to define it as God's grace is something you don't deserve. You haven't earned. It's not rightfully yours. But He gave it to you. Grace is tied closely to a word like gift. It is what He has freely given us. When we think that we are saved by grace, what are we saying? We are saying God has freely allowed us into the family. I say freely, free for you and me. It cost Him a lot. It cost Him His Son. But this grace means that it's not up to you to be perfect. You've already been justified. You have peace with God. Now you also have grace, which means you can come to Him at any moment. You will be received by Him. Why? Because He knows you could never do it on your own. But because of what His Son Jesus did in us, this grace is what we stand on. This free gift. This attitude of God that no, you didn't earn it. No, you don't deserve it. But you know what? You can stand on it. It'll hold you up. It'll carry you through. You can count on it every time you come to God. I know, man, last week I really lost it a few times. Listen, that grace means you're forgiven. That grace means you're still His. That grace means your bad attitude did not ruin the relationship. It's a grace in which we stand upon. And then we rejoice in the third thing, the hope of the glory of God. Because with this salvation we have in Christ, we've got a guarantee, a hope. We're going to heaven. We're going to be with Him someday. As bad as this life gets, I know where I'm going. I know where I'm going to end up. I've got that hope. And so this peace with God lets me know I can come to Him anytime. This grace with God lets me know He'll receive me at any time. This hope with God means I know one day I shall be with Him permanently in that glorious place. So as we lean on these things, we can look up and say the hope of this glory means that I know where I'm going. I've got some security here. Romans is all about telling you that what this great gospel has done for you is really good for Mondays and Tuesdays and Thursdays and Wednesdays and Fridays and any other time. It's good for good times. It's good for bad times. It will carry you through the darkness. It'll bring you light. It will do everything you're needing. You will get through every trial, every tribulation, even the ones you have no idea how you're ever going to get through. Because you've got peace. Because you've got grace. Because you've got hope. God has given us these things. And they're with us all the time. It's kind of like, you know, that feeling when you're walking in the store and you want to buy two Cokes and then you see the candy bar you just got to have and you know that's an extra $2. Unless you're at Stripes, then it's one for $2 and the next one's just $1. Right? They tell you that every time you come up there? And you're sitting there going, oh, no, I don't have enough. And you're about to reach down for your car keys. You realize you pull it out and there's a $10 bill in the pocket. That's a little about what having peace, grace, and hope are. You think you're at the end of your rope. You think you've got nothing. Then you stop and realize, wait a minute. I've got something in the pocket. I've got something God has given me. I've got something I forgot I had. Too often we forget, but let's remember. We've got this grace. We've got this peace. We've got this hope. They are given to us by God. They are given to us because of Jesus. They come to us not because we're better than other people, but because we just chose to believe that Jesus Christ died upon that cross for our sins and that He rose from the grave on the third day. So we've got it. Good. I have those things. How's it going to work? What's it going to do for me? Because He doesn't want to just leave us with, glory to God, you're saved. You're going to be in heaven someday. Remember, there's Mondays. So what does He tell us in the next verse? Verse 3. But not only that, not only do you have these gifts from God, but we also can glory not only in the gifts God gives us, but in the tribulations, the troubles, the problems He gives us. Because those are going to come, aren't they? The trials, the tests, the tribulations, the troubles, the hardships, they're going to come our way, aren't they? Well, is this theology stuff, is this peace and this grace and this hope going to do anything for me? And the answer is yes. Because with tribulations, as He says in verse 3, we know that tribulation produces something. What does it produce? It produces perseverance. That ability to keep going. You know, one of my favorite passages is in the Gospel of Luke, where Jesus says, men ought always to pray, and women and children and everybody else. We ought always to pray and never faint. Never give up is what that means. No matter what happens in our life, we don't stop. We don't stop believing. We don't stop praying. We don't stop serving. We don't stop hoping. We don't stop depending on the grace. We don't stop remembering we really do have peace. We don't need to drown that tension or that stress in a bottle or with a needle or with a pill. Why? Because we've got peace and grace and hope. And this trouble, God is going to use that peace, grace, and hope, and it's going to develop in me the strength to persevere, to keep going, to not give up. We go through struggles in life. But just like when we need to exercise our body, the more we exercise, the more our body can handle it. You know, if we sit on the couch all day and we just eat our Cheetos and drink our Pepsis, and then we get up and we find out, man, that walk from our front door to the car wears us out. And from the car to the church building wears us out. What if we exercised our body a little bit, put it under a little bit of trouble and tribulation, walked a bit around the neighborhood, did a little bit of jogging, a little bit of push-ups, those kind of things, and what happens? Our body starts to have a little more endurance with it. In our faith life, it really needs to be that way, that as we push, as we struggle, we get stronger. We know we've been through dark times, tribulations, but God comes through, and as God comes through, we learn to keep persevering, to not quit, to not give up. It would be so easy. But God says, you know, there's only one way to build stick-to-itiveness. And that's to get people to pull you away from it. There's only one way to build up the strength to get back up, and that's to knock you down. And the only way to go through these things, as He gives us tribulations, He builds us. He is not cruel. He has not abandoned us. He is not mean. He is building us. The strength to keep going. And perseverance does something else. Perseverance, it says in verse 3, produces, or verse 4 rather, perseverance produces character. Character. What does that mean? Well, we got lots of definitions in English. We got everything from somebody who's just a character, meaning they're the life of the party. They show out a lot. They're funny. They're quite the off-the-wall kind of guy. We've got other characters that they're just we put them into good or bad. The idea of character right here carries the idea of genuineness. Character in the idea of we've got strong character. We can be depended upon. We can be counted upon. We know we can be trusted. With character, he carries the idea of genuineness in the sense that here comes the trouble, the tribulation. It's building in a stick-to-itiveness, perseverance. And as a result of that perseverance, we start to change on the inside. And you can tell, they're a genuine believer. Why? Because they don't give up when hard times come. We can see their faith. How? Because they're going through troubles and they don't give up. And we start to see in their character the next time those troubles come, they're not in a panic state. They are prepared because they know one way or another, we're going to think, we're going to pray, and God's going to get us through this. We do not turn away. We do not shy away. We keep persevering, and that perseverance builds the character, the genuineness in us up and up. And we realize we start becoming the same person we are at home that we are in church. We start becoming the same person that we are at home and in church at work. They're throwing bombs all around us. They're cussing up a storm. They're trying to cut corners. They're doing all these things, and you're finding out, you know what? God is doing something in me. I'm just going to ignore all that and keep going. I can do my job without being like that. God builds character. And character, comes the full circle. Because it says in verse 4 that perseverance produces character, and character, hope. Well, I thought we already had hope. Yes, we do. But look how it brings it all around in the full circle. See, I have troubles. I have tribulations. But because I go through it with God, I start to persevere. I don't give up. God starts to build something inside of me that makes me ready for next time. Makes people see I'm the genuine article. And now, no matter what happens in my life, I know I've always got hope. Because you know what? As bad as this cancer may be, as bad as this loss may be, as bad as this bankruptcy, as bad as this problem, as bad as this trial may be, I know this. I've got Jesus. And that's my reaction to it. You see, that trouble brought perseverance. That perseverance brought character. That character brought us to realize I'm always going to have Jesus. I've got a home in glory that outshines the sun. I may have to downsize. I may have to cut back. I may have to do other things. But you know what? God is going to take care of me. I got hope. And look what verse 5 says. Now hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. Love that verse. And what we want to say there is that hope, we should never be embarrassed. It'll never make us ashamed. Because as long as we're looking to Him, we remember the fact that that love has filled us up. We've got this hope. Why? Because God loved us so much. Hope makes us not ashamed. Hope makes us not disappointed. Why? Because God's love has been poured out in us by the Holy Spirit, and He was given to us. You know, in other words, no matter what happens to me in life, I've got Him. The Holy Spirit was given to me. That love is poured out in my heart, and you can't take it away. You can't steal it from me. You can try and get my emotions to shift. You can try and get my mind distracted. But you know what? The simple fact is, I still got Him. And you can't get Him away from me, even if you tried. Hope does not disappoint. Because when we come to the end of our days and we see Him in glory, we're going to realize, you know what? I am not disappointed at all in what God drug me through. He did something in me. He gave me more of a life than I ever realized now that I see Him and what all He worked through us. Hope does not disappoint, does not make us ashamed, does not make us embarrassed. Hope reminds us we've got Him. And every day of my life, as bad as it gets, I know one day it's going to get better. I used to have this boss. His name was Joe. And whenever we'd gripe about how hot it was, whenever we'd gripe about how much our legs hurt or whatever else, we were demoing houses on an Air Force base outside of Little Rock up in Jacksonville, Texas. Or Jacksonville, Arkansas, rather. And it was hot, and we were getting tired, and there's all that sheetrock dust flying around. And well, Joe, I'm sick and tired of this. And Joe just said, it'll get better. And I sometimes think, you know, that's what hope is. It's telling me, you know, the trial, the struggle, the work, the dust, the grime, the grind, all of it, but it'll get better. It will be worth it. Now that's how it works. And you say, well, Pastor David, how do I know this will work? I know this will work because none of this is up to me. I know this will work because that peace thing and that grace thing and that hope thing, that it's not up to me. Verse 6. Listen, how do I know this will work? Because when I was still without strength, Christ died for this ungodly man. For you, you ungodly lady, ungodly young person, ungodly deacon, ungodly Sunday school teacher. He died for every one of us ungodly folks. Verse 7, you know, scarcely for a righteous person would someone die, and yet somebody for even a good man might die. You know, you don't want to give your life for one of them homeless guys out on the street. You don't want to give your life for somebody you barely know. But maybe for someone you do know that's a good person, yes, you'd lay down your life for him. But God, verse 8, demonstrates His love towards us that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. I know this works because He didn't wait for me to get better. He didn't wait for me to be perfect. He didn't wait for any of those things, but instead, His love has been demonstrated. I know I'm in secure hands because He didn't have a single reason to die for me other than love. I have nothing to offer Him upon that cross, and yet He offers me everything. And when I believe in that cross, suddenly all this stuff we talked about in verses 1 through 5 is ours. And how I know it works? Because the investment He's put into me with His love. He didn't just invest, He demonstrated it. How much does God love me? This much? This much? Like the old preacher used to say, he stretched his arms all the way out, I love you this much, and then he died. That's how much He loves you. That's how much He's invested in you so that when trials and tribulations come, He's got you. He would not cast you away. We get over to chapter 8 and it says it very clearly. How shall He who spared not His own Son not give us all things freely? God didn't even hold back His own Son. That's how His love has been demonstrated to you and me. How do I know this is going to work? Because I know He loves me and I've got no doubt about it. Why? Because I see that love in action with each pounding of that hammer, with each whip upon His back, with each thorn pressing into His brow, and each time that stone rolls another inch. I know. I know He loves me. So not only is it because of His love, but also I know this will work because reconciliation has been initiated. When we start reading verse 9, that word pops up about 3 times in there. Having been justified by His blood, we'll be saved from wrath through Him. Well, that's great. Saved from wrath, because when we were enemies, before we knew Christ, we were His enemies. Whether you like that word or not. If when we were enemies, we were reconciled through the death of His Son, much more, having been reconciled, we shall be saved by His life. See, without Christ, we basically were the enemies of God. How do I know this works? Because God did everything He could to let me stop being His enemy. We were justified, made innocent by His blood, and will be saved from wrath through Him. That wrath came because we were His enemies. But now, if when we were enemies, we were reconciled through the death, much more since we've been reconciled, we'll be saved through His life. In other words, that enmity, that hostility, that separation between us and God, when He died, took that away. Much more, when He rose from the grave, it says, by His life, since we've been recognized, we're saved by that rising from the dead. Verse 11, and not only that, but we rejoice through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received this reconciliation. Reconciliation is just kind of synonymous with that word we started with. We have peace with God. Peace. Reconciliation. Israel, Hamas, Iran, enemies, right? Hostility. There was an attack yesterday by Iran. God in His grace enabling Israel to protect itself through the, for the most part it looks like. And boy, be in prayer if this thing escalates. Can you imagine them reconciling after all that's happened? The leadership of Hamas, the leadership of Iran, Hezbollah, any of those terrorist groups or Iran, can you realize, say, you know what, Israel? We're just going to recognize you a nation. We're going to have peace. Let's start trading goods. Let's be friends. Can you imagine that happening? Not in our lifetime. But that basically is us and God. Our sin was offensive to Him as terrorism is to us. And yet, Him putting His Son down there to die upon that cross now enables us to be friends, to be reconciled, to have peace. Whatever God's going to do in the Middle East, we can pray about. We don't know. But we do know this. Every single one of us, whether we be a good Baptist or a good Methodist or an American or an Iranian or a Palestinian or an Israeli, every one of us that came to Jesus is now reconciled to God and has peace with Him and has access to peace, grace, and hope. God did that for us. Probably one of the problems between Israel and its enemies is there's no middle ground. The enemies don't want Israel to exist anymore. Israel is tired of fighting the terrorists. Israel is tired of these attacks. Listen. There probably will be no peace between them until Christ comes. But for us, we could never have found middle ground with God. So instead, He sent His Son. He initiated this reconciliation with that cross. He completed it with that empty tomb. And He says to you, here it is. Now, one side or the other in the Middle East could say, all right, let's do this. Let's just drop all hostilities. We all love one another and we lay out a little plan. Will you take it? Well, the other side, no matter which side it is going to say, wait a minute, we don't like your plan. Listen, when it came to God, His plan was perfect. And He's laid it out. If we want peace with Him, we come to Him. We become His. And that's the key to all of this. He did everything He could to bring this peace about. More than any diplomat, more than any negotiator, more than any other thing the UN could ever try to do, our God came down, God the Son, and gave His life to bring this reconciliation, that we could be His children. Again, the book of Romans tells us He's done everything possible to bring you close. Why do you resist Him? Why do you ignore Him? Why do you not have time for Him? Why is He on a back burner when He has done everything to build something with you? Yes, Pastor, I'm going through hard times. I can give you counsel, but it's still going to start with, get on your knees with Him and ask Him. Get your heart right with Him. Whatever else you're going through, you need Him right now. Whatever struggle, whatever bad thing, you need Him right now. And He has done everything to make it available to you. We kept saying that word grace is like a gift. So here we hand you a gift. What if you never unwrap it? What if you never bother to look inside the box? What if you just leave us standing here offering you something and you never take it? Yeah, I'll come get it in a minute, and here I am offering it to you. Right now, would you take the gift from Christ? You as a believer,
Would you realize, reach down into that pocket and realize, you know what, I left $10 in there. Reach down in the pocket and realize I got peace, grace, hope. I got a lot. And that peace, grace, and hope is going to build, and that troubles or tribulation is going to build perseverance and character and hope in me. I got a lot to go into this battle with. Would you realize that today? Maybe as a you're ready to say, you know, my life has been overwhelming, and this is exactly what I need, is somebody like Christ to come alongside me. And that can happen for you right now today if you've never done this before, that you could pray. You could simply ask, Jesus, would you come into my life? The Bible says, as many as receive Him, He gives the power to become the children of God. Would you do that today? We're going to sing a song here in a moment. And when we sing, maybe you want to come down and have me pray with you. But before we do that, we're going to pray right now. And as we pray, maybe you want to pray and tell Jesus you need Him. You need His help. Let's bow our heads and pray. Father in heaven, we love You. And God, right now, today, would You reach down into the hearts of these people? Holy Spirit, would You speak to them and let them know You are calling them. You are speaking to them. You are saying to them, this uncomfortable thing you've got is me speaking to you, is the Lord speaking to you. Telling you today you could open your heart up to Him. Lord, would You let them know that right now, here, they could just respond to the voice of the Spirit saying to them, I'm here. And we could say back to You, Lord, yes, I believe. I believe Jesus died for me. I believe He rose from the grave. Let me be one of Your children. Jesus, I need You in my life. With that simple prayer, Lord, remind them that everything changes. That they now can have this peace and this grace and this hope. That in their troubles, they can build perseverance and character and hope. That they are now reconciled and have peace with You. Lord, would You do this in us today? We pray this in that name above all names, the name of Christ. Amen. So we're going to sing, and if you're ready, if you want me to pray with you, if you're saying, you know, I really am ready to start following Christ, come down here and tell me about it. Let me pray with you. Maybe you're ready to say, I'm ready for baptism. I'm ready to follow Christ and be public with it. Come on down and tell me about it. Maybe if you're just ready to say, Lord, just Pastor, just pray for me. I got stuff going on. All right. Come down and I'll pray with you. Let's all stand. And we're going to sing. And while we sing, if you would like to, come down and let me pray with you.
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling.
Now, where you're at, saying to God, I'm ready.
For You and for me.
Is He calling you?
Why
today is the day to answer.
And heed not His mercies. Mercies for You and for me. Come home,
Thank you all for being with us this morning, and please remember we've got the schedule of everything going on this week on the back of the bulletin covers, and so please keep up with all that if you can. And then Will Sims, would you come and dismiss us, please?
Church, would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we are so blessed. We've been blessed by our Sunday school lesson. We've been blessed by this message given to us today. And forgive us for the times that we take all that for granted. We thank you for the missions that are accomplished by this church. And we'd ask that you would bless all of that. Heavenly Father, we're praying for the end of conflict in the Middle East. We pray that parties can get along and solve their differences. We pray for the division that's in our country, and that we will seek common ground and be reconciled with that. Give us the wisdom to do the things that we ought to, and with every decision, just ask yourself, am I doing the right thing? We know we have struggles in this life, and we don't always do them in the correct way. And we'd ask that you would forgive us those sins. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.